In the first video in this series, I made my first steps into machine learning using Jupyter notebooks. In this video, I want to take things one step further and make a reliable application that users can interact with. And for that, we're going to adopt some DevOps practices like data version tracking, continuous integration and automation, machine learning pipelines. All this will come together to make deployment safer, more reliable and easier. So to recap, the example we're going to use is a convolutional neural network that's fine-tuned to recognize cats and dogs. This is the dataset, and here we have the code we used for training and for testing the application. If you want to know more, you can go back and check our previous video. So why not choose Jupyter for everything? Well, Jupyter notebooks are great for experimentation, but they're really like Excel. We can do a lot with it, but in the end, it doesn't really scale, and we can't really call an Excel sheet an application. What we want to do is take that code and put it into a package we can deploy in a reliable way. In addition, sooner or later, our model will end up in some system. When it screws up, we need to know exactly what went wrong. And for that, we need to know exactly what code and what dataset went into the model. So for all that, we need to adopt some practices like data tracking and version tracking and put everything into a repository and we can deploy in a safe way. I have copied all the code into a repository. I will leave links to everything so you can clone the repository. First, we need to see a little bit the code. We have a file to prepare the data. We have a file to train, fine-tune the model, and we have another file to do the testing. Finally, we have the application file, which uses a Streamlit to run the application in a browser. So the code is all here, but we need to add a few things. We already have a Git repository to track the code, but we don't have any way to track the data. And here is where DVC comes in. It's an application that allows you to download data and use a hashing function to track the changes. It also allows us to run machine learning pipelines, which is like make files for machine learning. It can detect changes in the data or in the code and run the test or the training functions as needed. Get started, we need to install DVC, and once we install it, we need to run DVC in it. This will create a couple of folders. The first is the .dvc, which has a config. It also adds this file, which lets us ignore files for the DVC. So let's see how it works. Let's say we have some data we want to track. We're going to download it. This is the pets dataset. So the file is downloaded, and this is a big file, about 800 megabytes, so it's not really useful to put it and commit it on GitHub. Even at this size, it's a little bit unwieldy. So instead of doing that, we're going to use DVC to track this file. DVC, it's inspired by Git, so we use DVC add to add the file. What this will do is hash the file and add it into a special folder, which is DVC cache. This is in Git ignore. As you can see in the cache, the files are hashed using MD5. The files are moved into the cache, and then they are linked back into the original location. So this file is really a link to a file in the cache. The other thing that DVC does is adds a new file, which is the same name with the suffix DVC. This file has the hash of the original file, the size, and the path to the original file. This tells DVC where the file should be and what file to retrieve from the cache. If we check Git status, we see that the Git ignores are added and the .dvc file is also added. Note that the data itself is not added because it's on the Git ignore. We are only pushing the pointers to the data and the hashes of the data into Git so we can track which dataset we are using in our training. The other useful feature for us is machine learning pipelines. These are like make files for machine learning, and we use the DVC stage add command. Here we have an example. We use dash n to add the name of the stage, and with dash d we add the dependencies. These are the inputs of that DVC will monitor for changes. Then with dash o is the output of the process. The final part of the command is the command that's going to run to convert the inputs into outputs. So in this case, I'm taking the prepare script, which unpacks the tarball, and we are saying that it's going to output files in the data/images directory. So when I execute this command, a new file is created, which is called dvc.yaml. And this simply is a YAML file with the command, the dependencies, and the outputs. Here we have a message that we should commit this file into the repository because this is part of the tracking we have, we know which commands and dependencies are used for running each stage. Now, to run this stage, we use the command dbc repro. This is going to check which file has changed. It's going to check out the files from the dbc cache, and it's going to run the commands that it needs to run. So here we can see that the tarball has been decompressed. The images are here in my data/images directory. Running dbc repro creates a new file called dbc.log. This is the log file. It only preserves the state of our pipeline, so it adds on the dbc.yaml. So this file is very important. We need to check it also into the Git repository. Let's add another stage. This one is going to be called train, and we're going to also put the inputs. Here is the train script and the data/images, which contains our training dataset. These are the outputs, which are the model files that are going to be produced by the training script. And then these plots are also another kind of output. Saying they are plots, we can use different commands to compare them. And these are images that the train.py script creates. They are the confusion matrix, the top losses, and the fine-tuned results. These are all things that we have seen in the previous video. Final part is the script that will run. Every time we add a stage or we modify a stage, we need to commit the dbc.yaml. Now, if you run dbc repro, it's going to skip the prepare because nothing changed on the dataset, and it's going to only run the training script. This will take about a minute to run in my machine, and once it's done, it's going to create the plots and the model files. So while the model trains, let me tell you how DVC handles the data. As you can see, we don't push the data into the Git repository. It's only running in my local machine. But what happens if we want to share this data or keep it in the cloud? Well, DVC supports remote storage. We can add remotes in the same way we add a remote in Git. DVC supports various types of buckets and remote storage, like S3 in AWS. You can have Google Cloud. You can even have your own server and copy everything using SSH and SFTP. Let's see an example. I have configured a bucket using AWS. It's called Semaphore MLOps. And to add the remote, we use dbc remote add. We add a name for the repository and then the path, the URL to the bucket. Next, we need to run dbc remote default to say that this is the default remote. And then we can run dbc push, and this will automatically push all the required file into the cache. And in the same way, I can run dbc pull to pull the cache into my machine. So with this system, I can share all the dataset, all the model, every file that I have ever tracked with DVC into my machine and work with that. So this is great because DVC takes care of everything, the data. It knows which files it needs to pull. It knows which files have been used for each revision of the model. And it can reproduce any model at any point in the Git history because this is all tied to the Git history. So finally, the model has been trained. We have new files here in the models directory. And if we go to the metrics folder, we are going to see the confusion matrix and the results of the fine tuning and the losses. Let's finish the pipeline by adding one more stage. This stage is called test, and it takes the test script, the models from the previous stage, and this will basically run some inference on some images. Let's run dbc repro, and it's going to only run the test because the prepare and the train stages have not changed, the data has not changed. So the only thing that needs to run is dbc test. Let's run dbc repro again. And in this case, it's not going to run anything because nothing has changed. So everything is reproducible by any other developer or by a CI system. The final thing I want to show you is the dbc DAG command. This will parse the dbc YAML and show me the dependency wrap. We can see in what order the stages will run. If you check out the main branch of the repository, you are going to find, in addition to the complete examples, you also find a continuous integration pipeline. This is on Semaphore, and I want to show you a little bit very quickly how it works. We have the first part, which consists of two blocks. Here we are going to install DVC, and we are going to clone the repository and pull the data using DVC pull. Here I have opened the pipeline. As you can see, we are going to run here the dbc repro command, and then we are going to push the metrics and the model into the artifact here on Semaphore. And finally, we are going to push the changes in the cache to the S3 bucket. The second block holds everything from the artifact repository and runs repro test. Then I have added two more pipelines. One builds a Docker image, it checks out the code and runs Docker pull, Docker build, and Docker push. This pushes the images into Docker Hub. And let me show you the final pipeline. This is continuous deployment pipeline. It takes code, checks out the code from Git, it pulls the artifact that we trained in the pipeline and runs deploy. So here I have my application on Streamlit. This is running on Hugging Face using the Streamlit library. Let me test the model. I will upload an image of my cat and push the buttons to get a prediction. It's saying it's a cat, so it's running. So thank you for watching this video. DVC helps a lot into building machine learning pipelines and making everything more reproducible without having to rely on notebooks. We can use to train and manage the data and keep everything in one place. So if you like this video, please like, subscribe so you don't miss the next one. And I will keep making videos on this subject in the future. So thank you for watching and have a nice one.